Mini chapter 60, Ashley and Dad attack Kim. Kim, Jaymi calls out with an affable smile, wandering across the lower end of his garden to where this beast is sitting alone on the lush lawn in contemplation of the span of LA below. Allow me to take you to the Hollywood Cafe. Yeah, I've heard a little something about that place from Shigem, says Kim, looking up at his maker guardedly. He got back from there a couple of hours ago and had to go lie down in the bedroom and recover. Ah, okay, well, you may not have heard the most flattering account of it then. I think he's still sleeping it off. He didn't seem quite able to explain what happened, but I got the sense that it's quite a tough crowd in there. I confess it may not become a regular haunt of yours, says Jaymi, but I do need to throw you into the external world, like throwing you into a swimming pool to teach you how to swim. And trust me, the Hollywood Cafe is nearer the shallow end of the pool than the deep end. Sorry, Kim, there's no way around it. The external world sucks in many ways, but it's the only one I can offer. You're dressed quite smartly enough already for company that deems itself civilized, so let's just go to the car now and get it over with, shall we? Come on. Fighting down his own escalating jitters throughout the journey, Jaymi is glad of this beast's natural taciturnity as they drive, in apprehensive silence, over to the Hollywood Cafe. As soon as they enter, he spots Dad and Ashley having after-work drinks at a table by the far wall, as hoped. Once again, he feels that alien thrill at being able to perceive their oncoming faces through the eyes of a new beast as well as through his own. And this time, if he's not mistaken, Ashley in particular is taking in the newly minted Kim with an odd burn of fascination that Jaymi didn't quite see in her when he led first Evelyn and then Shigem between these tables. But as expected, both Dad's and her scrutiny of this fourth beast, introduced to them by Jaymi with the customary breeze of genial small talk, is beady-eyed with the mission to reproduce Jamie's breakthrough Kim creation, but repurposing him instead into an enhancement for Ain't They Freaky. Yes, the ugly ambition in Dad's face is clear. He would like nothing better than to incorporate a dumbed-down version of Kim into his own tabloid product, so as to entertain customers of the Trivia Score, Wacky or Boring newsfeed, no doubt setting up Bang Dead's cartoony Kim as a kind of reference target for a world full of trivia scorers to mock and take aim at. While Dad contemplates all this commercial potential in Jaymi's beast, it's clear, too, that he's looking at him through the eyes and expectations of an average consumer of Ain't They Freaky. And as soon as Dad looks at him in this way, the main problem becomes apparent. Kim thinks too much. To speak plain, as Dad so prides himself on doing, it will need a bit of straightening out for normal people. Just as soon as Herb's team have worked out how he was created and have found a way to reverse engineer him, then that excessive seriousness of mind will be the first thing to fix. Jaymi pulls his own attention out of Dad and returns it to Kim. Doing so, he is distraught to observe that Kim's apprehension of the Bang Dead duo's avid intentions is spreading through him like a seepage of pain. Although Kim manages to maintain his external composure, the mere prospect of being repurposed comes at him like an assault, threatening not just to down-convert him into a form that feels cheaper, but to do violence to his own self and truth, to use his precious life for something other than he wants. This ominous prospect acts as a natural trigger for Kim's first incarnated apprehension of the innate separateness of all human beings from one another. What unbridgeable separateness it is, too, involving such unmerciful magnitudes of distance. Even when in company with one another, it seems every incarnated human is just as alone as that far future astronaut who will fly back home at such warp speed that they'll find the Earth has aged a million years during the course of their own mere few years flying, returned now to a planet where only they themselves must remain alone until their death. But that's just the standard-issue sadness of distance. Whereas Dud's and Ashley's attack incorporates a still greater assault, he feels. It seems they want to morph Kim into a form where he's no longer inclined to take account of the suffering caused in people by their incarnations. People would be more than they are, Kim can see, if they weren't so powerfully targeted by the likes of Ashley and Dud and Bang Dead and their soul-dead trivia. Then how much more would people be inclined to think and to look into others around them, searching not for their own littleness, but for what to build, onwards and upwards together? For how many of the most beautiful feelings in the world are born only to be crushed, frustrated, overridden by lesser feelings, lesser forces? How huge a proportion of the world's population is hungry, and how many more in misery? The vulnerability and frequent defeat of the finest feelings and achievements, the fact that finer aspirations are so regularly broken, that such breakage passes so often unnoticed, and that this unnoticing prevails unpunished, these are perpetual tragedies. Kim is baffled, in particular, by the infernal depths to which pain and illness are capable of descending in some cases, often with such suddenness and permanence. Contemplating anyone who's in such a position, their life filled with physical fuck-up, he feels he's looking into a pit. An undamaged person and such a damaged one are both just flesh, so why such an extreme difference in their positions? And with what ease might their roles have been reversed? A mere 5 minutes in the company of an extreme sufferer is challenging enough, he perceives. Having to see that sufferer 24 hours a day, year after year, would be worse. Having to be them would be a hell beyond hell. As a result of many kinds of accident or condition that happen to individuals, an incarnated human may arrive at a point of knowing that all pleasures for the rest of their entire life will feel nasty, sick, and soiled, that nothing will be real to them anymore except pain. Kim imagines it, whining with good reason at being broken by nothing but a single evil chance. Every tiny speck of progress through every long day of their remaining life to be undertaken through the ugly gloves of illness and pain, to have the confusion and sadness of sickness without the possibility of its ever ending throughout their remaining years. On top of the gross, muffling phenomenon that is simple incarnation to begin with, how weary and filthy and forever poisoned is the lot that was drawn by such a person. To respect such a grand design strikes Kim as a challenge. 20 minutes later, driving a silent passenger out of Hollywood, a sobered Jaymi reflects on what Duds and Ashley's presence has just inflicted on this new beast's clarity and truth. And he wonders, as a means to his own ends, was it despotic of him to put Kim through all this, necessary though it was to toughen him up for life in the real world? He wonders another thing, too. Does Kim feel like a beast as opposed to a human? Deep inside Kim, is there, in fact? And somewhere inside himself, he quivers.